This is University. Welcome to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today, Ivan Illich, director of Centro Intercultural de Documentación, Cuernavaca, Mexico, lectures on A Call for Institutional Revolution. This is the fifth in a series of seven special lectures given as part of Iowa State University's World Affairs Institute on Latin America. Mr. Illich.
Before starting, I walked around a little bit, trying to understand why so many people turned out, which made me first discard the manuscript which I wrote for this purpose because I had mistaken Iowa for Idaho and had written on rural education something very formal which I gave to Mr. Stephen Smith for publication so that it can appear because he needs a manuscript. And when I had taken out another manuscript, I discarded both of them and thought, I just will very freely and simply sum up as quickly and as in as condensed a way as I can a few points about school in order to see one particular way in which Latin America can provide technical assistance for our North American brothers. Because there are certain aspects of modern technology and of modern institutionalization which do manifest the internal contradictions, their absurdity best when we transplant them into areas which are less rich, which cannot afford as extraordinary, beautiful, and enjoyable an auditorium as this one here. So I thought for the moment of proceeding in this way. I'm told that the acoustics here are very good. I will explain what school does economically in North and South America. Then I will explain what school does psychologically and sociologically in South and North America equally. Then I hope to be able to point out to you why I have reasons to believe that during the year 1971, the major discovery, unless we should have a catastrophic war or something, in civilized nations will be the awareness that the school system has broken down yesterday, that we don't have to bring it down in any way, and from there ask myself what would be the alternative to a society which is all schooled up, as one of the men of the Black Economics Committee once said to me, and he said to me, yeah, I know school is made to school you. And in the afternoon, everybody showed up with buttons, school you. First, let me look at what school does in Latin America. In Latin America, we do not have one country which spends less than 20% of its national budget on education, which of course is identified as schooling, as classroom assistance of age-specific groups in front of a teacher, under the presidency of a teacher, to participate in a so-called scientifically planned curriculum. That's what I mean by schooling. Many countries spend more. In some countries, it goes beyond 30% of national budget spent on this process. There's not one Latin American country left which has not made 5 years of school attendance obligatory. There's not one country in which actually a full third of the young population finishes the fifth grade. 5 years of obligatory schooling, therefore, provide an insurance for the country that two-thirds of the young people will not have fulfilled their basic civic duty and therefore, for the rest of their lives, can be considered as people who are at least partially disenfranchised. In quite a few countries, thanks to technical assistance from the North, we are now very seriously thinking about raising the minimum level of schooling which is obligatory, thus restricting further the people who can fulfill their legal obligation to go to school. and during the rest of their lives can be told that since we have not finished schooling, they don't have the normal privileges, economic, political, or prestige-wise. What school teaches all people who go for 1 or 2 years is that they should get more of it, and that those who have gotten more are somehow better people. To go for a moment back to some very general data, there is no country in Latin America in which a comparison between the median student, I'm not speaking of the average student, the median student and a university student would not give a disproportion of $1 to $350 spent on his education. That is, any university student in Mexico gets 350 times as much money out of the tax till than the median student. In Bolivia, of course, it goes up to one compared with 1,400. I am not aware yet of anybody having written a dystopia, the opposite of an utopia, describing for me a social system, a social mechanism, which would provide that rude an exploitation of the great majority by a very few, with that enthusiastic a participation of the exploited. Just for those who want to claim the price, I have a whole box of tequila sealed standing in our center in Sidoc in Cuernavaca for somebody who wants to claim it because he has written such a dystopia. Now, in Latin America, if you are born in the better countries, in the countries which provide more effectively schools for all, such as Costa Rica or Mexico, if you are born in the lower fifth of the population, you don't have a chance, more than a chance out of 20, to finish the amount of obligatory schooling, which is 5 or 6 years, respectively, in these two countries. The attempt to transfer the school system as the main instrument for education from developed countries into poorer countries is therefore absurd. It leads only to a further hardening, or if you want, to a modernization of a class structure. Because what is typical about the school system is that it introjects a very clear perception of the class level to which you belong. The modern world has 16 class levels. Schools everywhere in the world comes in quanta of 4 years. Less than 4 years is just not worthwhile, according to educators, to go to. Even though, educators of the last century, for instance, Mr. Jefferson, still could say that we need at least 3 years of schooling to rake a few geniuses from the ashes of the masses. This was, of course, one man. Your school system has grown out of this. Modern educators know that less than 4 years have no effect whatsoever, and school comes everywhere in the world, from Russia to China and from Peru to the United States, basically, as a pyramid of four quanta of 4 years successively on top of each other. Everywhere in the world is such a pyramidal system. If you drop out of the fifth grade or of the third grade anywhere in the world, you know very well into which level of the world class system you belong, which might be more important than any one of the old ideological conceived class structures of which we usually speak. School is another power, of course. It can create an international caste. You say caste or caste? Indian castes or caste? An international caste system. Countries can be arranged on an international scale for evaluation according to the average amount of schooling per capita which we can provide. And in all these comparisons, of course, the rich countries which can afford the greatest input of teaching into their citizens forever justify their exploitation of the rest of the world, because school serves as a measuring instrument of the amount of consumption which you are entitled to in all other areas. After all, we know, at least this is what we learn in school, that our productivity is very tightly measured by the amount of schooling which we have received, this notwithstanding all the studies which are beginning to appear that there is very little relationship between the actual ability, effectiveness at work, and the amount of schooling a man has received in the given area. The best book in the United States on this field is probably Ivar Berg, B-E-R-G, The Great Training Robbery, which was published this spring at Columbia Institute for Urban Studies, in which he points out that there is very little proven correlation between job effectiveness and schooling, while there's a very close relationship between income and status in a given profession and the amount of schooling a person has received. But anyway, this system which you are exporting into Latin America, which is being imported in Latin America, does not have really much different effects in the United States. You know that probably that last spring two studies came out, one from the University of Miami and one made directly by HEW. This was at the time when Mr. Nixon announced that every child should have the right to read, and he himself corrected that the both things have to be written with a big R when he leaves school. This was a study which pointed out that in the United States, in order to provide equal educational opportunities on the grammar and high school level, instead of the $40 billion roughly spent now, $110 billion would have to be spent. That is, the entire Pentagon expenditure, including the War of Vietnam, thrown into education would be barely sufficient to provide equal access to equal educational opportunities as we conceive them at this moment in the United States. Another good example of the economic crisis into which school is moving in this country is probably provided by the poverty, by the Title I program, which plowed $1 billion a year during the year 66, 67, and 68 into the ghettos in order to equalize educational opportunities for the educationally underprivileged. According to a study made nearby here in Ann Arbor, directed, I think, by Mr. Newcomb, which studied 160 different attempts to evaluate the effectiveness of that $1 billion, it seems pretty clear that we can say that during the 3 years of operation of this program, while $3 billion just disappeared from the federal budget, because at the end of the program, there was only evidence that the poor, that this difference between the education of the poor and the education of the average student in US cities had moved apart, strangely enough, while in the 3 years of operation of the program, which was meant to equalize the opportunities for 6 million people, 6 million children of the poor, an additional 10 million of educational underprivileged had been discovered. Now, all these paradoxes are reaching the level of public awareness at this moment. And we have to ask ourselves, therefore, how come did we not see them earlier? How come did we not realize earlier, and how come today most adults do not yet realize that most learning is not the result of teaching? That in order to learn something, you do not have to go to a person who is specializing on transmitting that learning. How come only now we are becoming somewhat doubtful of several of the hypotheses on which schooling is built? One of them being, for instance, that people do not have time or motivation to learn unless they are bribed or compelled. And that the poorer a person is, the more I must bribe him or compel him so that he learns something. The amazing thing is, in fact, as in an earlier seminar we said this evening, that the leaders of the poor reinforce this opinion of the pedagogue that the poor have a right that money be spent on bribing them or compelling them to learn. Or another strange hypothesis about schooling, which is really new. School is built, modern school, the school of the 70s. I'm not speaking of the school of the 60s or much less of the school of the 20s, which was, quite frankly, a social control and selection mechanism. I'm speaking of the school which we have finally succeeded to have in the United States. It is built on the idea that there is a secret to everything a man can meet in his life. There's a secret about this, and there's a secret about this, and there's a secret about society, and there's a secret about buildings. And if I know that secret, somehow my life will be more valuable. But knowing a secret, being initiated into the secret of what I do or meet, is something which can be performed only by a person who has been ordained for this purpose, who has been certified, a teacher. And that learning is more valuable when it happens under the presidency of a teacher, under the guidance of a teacher, quite, and even better if it happens under a teacher in a carefully ordered process which we call a curriculum. How come that all these statements, which when you make them now, seem, at least for many people, or begin to seem strange, became tolerable for us over the last few years? My hypothesis or my answer to this would be very simple. School, de facto, must be understood as a worldwide ritual, which really was adopted as a world ritual by the great masses only during the last 10 years. Certainly, if you look at this was in 1962, there was a big meeting of UNESCO on education in Santiago. If you look through these reports of the specialists who met there, the main concern was, how can we, I'm putting it in rough words, convince these stupid rural inhabitants of Latin America that they should send their children to school? How can we teach them that their children need to go to school? Only 8 years, 10 years later, everywhere in Latin America, the expectation for schooling exceeds enormously the possible available resources for school. Because even if you spent all over Latin America the entire national budget only to build schools, you still wouldn't get everybody through the 5 years which have been declared obligatory. How come such a strange mania could develop all over Latin America and probably even wider, could expand also into certain countries of Africa? I do believe that this could happen only because schooling became increasingly a ritual form of behavior thoroughly of one piece with modern consumer society. Let me see what I learn in school. First of all, in school I learn that learning is the result of teaching, or is at least more valuable when it happens as the result of my client relationship to a big institution. Learning itself, human growth, necessarily in school becomes transformed into an institutional dependence of the individual. But it's not only that I learn that values can be institutionally produced, and once a man accepts that his learning is a result of teaching, he's quite willing to accept any other value as dependent on the production mechanism of a large institution producing either a good or a service. But one learns also that it is measured, quantifiable, a quantifiable process. Learning comes in 1 year or 4 year units. And the sense of measurement is introjected, is interiorized through the schooling process. And once a man has become measurable, his worth has become measurable. In terms of schooling, his worth on the market is too measurable. In other words, school is the initiation ritual to the society built on the ideal to produce institutionally values and human beings capable of degrading these values, consuming them, in order to increase the flow of goods or services which these large institutions can continue to put out. Third, school is a ritual which not only introduces me to the idea of consumption of services which are institutionally produced and which are measurable, but which program further hunger. Because certainly when I reach the fifth grade, I am much more aware of the importance of going on to the sixth than I was in the first grade, convinced of the importance of going on to the second. Schooling ritually, symbolically introduces me to the idea that goods or services come on a pyramidal ladder in progressively more expensive quanta, and that he who is capable of consuming these quanta, using them, becomes progressively more valuable. So that in an extraordinary way, school introduces me to consider consumption as a necessary element, consumption of institutionally planned and produced values, as a necessary element of being human. To speak in a biblical analogy, I would say, the old Moloch, the pagan Philistine god against whom the Jews were warned, only ate children. You could sacrifice your children to the Moloch and burn them in the oven in the stomach of God Moloch. The modern consumer learns to build institutions which produce values which he becomes capable of consuming, devaluating, eliminating, at the service of the world in which the flow of such institutionally produced values thereby increases. School, therefore, ritually, symbolically trains for the institutionalization of measurable, increasingly more valuable or more expensive values, which can be interiorized and thereby degraded. Max Gluckman, the anthropologist, in his study of African ritual, says that a ritual is a behavior form which hides from those who participate in this behavior the contradiction in their society between social structure and social goals. School does this brilliantly. Why do we have schools? Because we want to compel everybody to equality. We want to compel all people to play at a gambling system. And school can be described very well. One of the models which I can build up for it is that of a gambling system. School wants to compel everybody to compete for equality in a system which necessarily has limited resources. Now, competition for equality, if there are any mathematicians among you, you'll tell me, is one of the most dynamic ways in which we can describe the contradictory or absurd. As long as we therefore will believe that compulsory learning in a graded system can lead to equality, we will remain tolerant, capable of tolerating an economic structure which is built on the idea of a growth economy, which in our myth equalizes chances. Somehow in our imagination equalizes not only opportunities but consumption, while in reality it leads to increased social polarization. The more a man learns that the next step of consumption would be more desirable than that which he has reached, the more his hunger, I mean an empty stomach, is transformed into non-satiety, having the bottom fall out of one's stomach, ability to degrade any amount of value, and whereby those who do get higher up on the consumption ladder, monopolize more and more of the public resources. Therefore, the economy for which school trains us for the tolerance of a polarizing society and a society in which the individual becomes increasingly more passive, dependent on institutionally planned and produced values. What I do believe is happening at this moment and will be happening particularly during the year 1971 will be a very widespread insight into the ritual nature of schooling. The reason, let's say the occasion for the crisis of school will most probably be an economic one. Demand for schooling, for more expenditure on schools, rises exponentially in comparison with the amount of schools which you have available. This is quite evident. If you get more people into college, into first year of college, we know that the fourth year of college is more expensive than the first year, more people will demand to go into the fourth year. This can be also rewritten, this sentence, in terms of an application of Parkinson's law to education, either stating that education of any given subject can be planned so that it costs any amount which you choose to spend on it. Or, in other terms, that learning difficulties, in economic terms at least, as the economists can study them, learning difficulties increase with the amount of money spent on the teaching of a given subject. I had a very good example of this just about 6-8 months ago. I was in Paris and made this statement to a group of planners of education in Paris. Well, you can imagine the reaction I got. Mais monsieur, perhaps this can happen in the United States, but here in France. I said, but careful, you are beginning to spend in this particular group of people for which he spoke, more than $350 per capita per year. And that is the point where everywhere in the world reading difficulties begin to appear in a school system. Monsieur, you think American, but this does not happen in France. Only 6 months or 7 months later, I was again in Paris, and subrepticiously, a gentleman who was at the last meeting took out a piece of paper and pointed out that the Ministère de l'Éducation Publique had information that 1/5 of all young people who got into the lycée do not read well enough to go on to the university. So, I'm giving you this is just as one little example. I'm pretty sure that during the next year or 2 years, it will become quite evident that the commitment which we all have made towards the increase of education through school is absurd. Taxpayers, students, government officials will simply come to the realization, and are coming at this moment to the realization, that school cannot serve as the central public agency to organize the educational effort of a community. I am aware that this statement only a year ago was always greeted with incredulity, almost as some kind of one more, in Spanish we say, una afirmación descabellada, an unruly, crazy statement. We are at this moment, I guess, at least in the United States, passing through those months during which increasingly people say there is something to the idea that school cannot serve as the central agency to provide planned educational opportunities. I'm purposely hedging it in these terms. I am pretty sure that during the year 1971, a very sudden change in consciousness will happen all over the United States. People will suddenly become aware of the fact that school has moved off center stage. Social changes, if they are deep and radical, if they are changes of consciousness about what is necessary and what is possible, that is, true cultural revolutions, cannot be planned. They usually happen, as John Platt points out so well in a paper on mathematics of time perception, in the same way in which the whirlpools underneath a waterfall suddenly change. I don't know if you have ever looked at waterfalls. We have these beautiful vortex structures underneath. And I always, as a child, wanted to see once how it changed. I never succeeded. But I know winter and summer, with more or less flux going through, the whirlpools are at the same place. And then suddenly, somewhere a large stone falls into the pool, or a tree is felled, and suddenly, without the flux changing, the entire pattern rearranges itself. The educational scene of the United States makes much more sense once we believe, we trust that that society can be de-schooled. And I am pretty sure that within the next 6 or 8 months, suddenly lots of people will see that most of the facts we know fit a society which moves towards de-schooling much better than the society which we believe is necessary, namely one in which graded progress through a school system is the central initiation ritual of any citizen. Now, what I would call here de-schooling can quite evidently take two different directions. One, for the purposes of such a simple black and white presentation as necessarily such a chat must be, I would call the de-schooling of education, the breakdown of trust in the school mechanism, 1 to 16th grade. The other one I would call, more than that, the de-schooling of society. The fact that most learning, which happens at this moment in our society, outside of schools, is pretty evident. The most difficult things most people learn, they learn without anybody purposely trying to instruct them. They learn to speak, they learn to walk, they learn to recognize things, they get informed about the world. What makes teaching at this moment for many of my colleagues in slum schools in the United States, and much more in middle-class schools, difficult is that the kids know about subject matters so much more than their teacher because they are brought up in front of the television screen. They are brought up in a very modern world, and very frequently teachers then take recourse to one simple argument to justify that there remains a certain superiority to them by saying the kids know the facts, but the wisdom we, of course, have, and we must somehow share with the children. It is quite clear that most learning doesn't happen outside of school only because it happens in the old and traditional way, quite incidentally and in an unplanned form, but because the media, the show windows, the catalogs, the newspapers, radio, TV, movies, do transmit in a planned way, in the institutionally programmed way, an awful lot of information about society, acculturation, and challenge to think. In view of this fact, the people who simply want to de-school society can take two simple, radically distinct approaches. In order not to call them left and right, let me call them Jacobin and Bourbon. The Jacobin educator, the great liberal educator, some of the best people I know, say, the breakdown of school provides us educators with the opportunity to assume, to expand the area of our responsibility for public education, to take over radio, TV, the organization of daily life. Basically, they are disappointed utopians. They wanted to create a new man, I'm sloganeering at this moment, by putting children for 5 or 10,000 hours during their lifetime into the new society of the classroom. And to their great amazement, no new man comes out. So they transform, again to caricature, the world into a classroom. Their ideal would be modern society conceived as one big classroom in which not only the school seat, but many other much more intimately touching media funnel professionally developed information programs to the individual. This is, if you want, the de-schooling ideal of the Jacobin. The de-schooling ideal of the Bourbon looks somewhat different. He says, there's no breakdown in schools. There's only a breakdown in the dreams of the liberal educator. Universal competition for equality, which becomes obligatory, is absurd. Schools become miserable, cease to teach when they become vulgar and accessible to everybody. There's nothing wrong with schools. There's only something wrong with the idea of wanting to provide everybody with them. I'm speaking about the Bourbon educator, especially because one lady over there told me that I was identified as such a man in your community. Because you see, the modern Bourbon is really not only the man I met some months ago with the headmasters of some Eastern prep schools. These were quite frank Bourbons. He said the school system works very well for our kids in the prep schools. But the modern Bourbon very frequently is not aware of the fact that he's a Bourbon, because the elite which he gets into his free school is a selection of black, of poor, of Puerto Rican children, on whom he pours as much money, if not more money, than is available in a rich school. His elite is an elite taken from among the poor, to whom he takes a special liking or for whom he has a special interest, and therefore he isn't aware of the fact that he is a Bourbon. But in both senses, both the Jacobin who wants to transform the world into a classroom and the Bourbon who becomes aware of the fact that school must become again selective, de-schools or tries to break down the present ideology of a universal school system, he does not think about inverting school. I do believe that the great challenge of 1971-72 will be the attempt to de-school not just the education system, but society as a whole. What we need to do is to turn the basic idea of school topsy-turvy. I described school before as a funnel, which funnels increasingly more complex programs into your mind. And the ideal school is a school which has hundreds of buttons, programmed learning, where I can pick out which funnel I want to attach myself to so that my learning be the result of carefully prepackaged consumption of teaching. of consumption of carefully prepackaged teachings. The inverse of school would be the creation of a society in which all men have access to all the resources which are usually needed in order to learn. The contrary to a funneling system, to a production system, is a network. A network of access, of bridges, of channels, by which everybody has equal access, not to prepackaged teaching programs, but to the opportunities of learning. And for that purpose, I would distinguish these basic learning resources into four big classes. Let me again go to Latin America instead of staying in North America. People need access to things. Modern merchandise has become totally non-transparent, obscure. There was no dearth, although for you, those of you who remember Latin America 20 years ago, of people who knew how to repair radios of the type which were produced 30 and 40 years ago. Because 2 or 3 years after the radio arrived somewhere in the Andes, there was somebody around who knew how to repair it. Those of you who have that horrible age of mine of 44 will remember when we got the first family radio to cannibalize and to play with because it was being discarded. You remember how many things one could make out of such a radio. One could make the whole neighborhood whistle with feedback with a transmitter one constructed out of that radio. You remember that, right? Modern radios, yesterday I had one in my hands, say, careful, don't open, no user repairable pieces contained in this piece of equipment. They are plastic. Modern society, modern consumer goods, which are exported into Latin America, are simply useless as teaching tools. One major policy, therefore, of deschooling is perhaps a review of the type of consumer goods which we can afford to import because of their educational value. I heard that yesterday Mr. Anderson spoke about one of my pet projects, to try to imagine what the world would look like if we reviewed transportation. Make a little parenthesis here only. From an educational point of view, what would happen? In Latin America, let me take a country X, let me imagine it is Peru, which has 40,000 hamlets. In such a country, cars, according to a study which I have, but I don't trust it yet fully, I've asked somebody else to do another one, cars, in the period of a whole lifetime in which they survive, travel only 1% of the time at speeds above 40 miles, and only 4% of that lifetime at speeds above 25 miles. Why? Because the roads on which one could travel, which are open, are so bad that the car would break down if you traveled faster, and the roads which are good are so clogged with other cars that you can't move any faster. Therefore, if we had, it is possible for us today, a friend of mine is just beating it through the 30,000th mile to see how it stands up, to build burros mecánicos, mechanical burros, donkeys. I have one at this moment which we are testing. The cost is still too high. We still have to get it down by 30%, but the cost at this moment is $130 a piece. Most of its pieces should outlast 10 or 15 years. It can run at speeds of 20 miles over rough terrain. It can climb 30 degrees inclines. It can carry 850 pounds, which is most anything you want to transport except steel beams and trunks, tree trunks. It can be constructed in factories, the unit cost per factory being somewhere between $200,000 and $300,000. Therefore, Surlandia, whichever country we might choose, could afford 4 or 5 or 6 of these factories and make it obligatory for everybody who wants to acquire a burro to work at every part of its process of building and therefore learn anything you have to know about modern mechanics. Now, economically it works out as follows. Let me assume that I have a country with 40,000 hamlets. It would cost me about $10 to $12 million to connect all these hamlets with 6 feet wide dirt trails and provide, on the average per hamlet, 5 burros for $12 million. Now there are many countries in Latin America which at this moment spend that amount on cars and road building per year. Imagine what kind of a political challenge it would be to say, if I can stay in power, I will see to it that everybody around here, every fifth person, gets a burro. I'm just speaking about alternative uses of technology in order to increase personal mobility, personal enterprise, but also learning possibilities. Let me give you another example. I'm not saying that I advocate this directly, but just in order to explain what I mean by the difference between de-schooling in direction of a universal classroom as opposed to de-schooling in direction of a more transparent world. With the amount of money now invested in TV in Latin America, one could have equally well equipped every seventh adult in Latin America with his own tape recorder. You know, audio tape recorder. And recorded cassettes. Plentiful, so that they cease to be of any economic value, because while books, unless they are sold at a certain price, would be abused for the building of huts. I recently went to the market in order to try it out and asked a group of kids to take 20 cassettes and show me what else could be made out of a cassette but a cassette. But cassettes are evidently totally useless for anything else but being cassettes. Therefore, one can render them absolutely plentiful, recorded cassettes and non-recorded cassettes. But to the difference of a TV, a cassette provides the opportunity for everybody really to have equal access to education, meaning both teaching and learning. I'm giving you this as an example, just in order to put into images what would take too long to describe in complex sentences. To sum up, I do believe that a comparison between schooling in North and South America heightens the insight for every North American that the reliance of school as the principal agent for public education is at the point of breakdown. This insight is heightened further when we become aware of the fact that school serves as the major ritual of a consumer society and an economy which maximizes flows and incomes and progress to increasingly more expensive and complex quanta of consumption. Once, I do believe that during the year 1971 and 72, trust in schools will suddenly publicly break down. At that moment, we have two major choices. Either we in principle stay with the basic ideology on which school is built, namely that learning in a modern society must be the result of learning intake of carefully planned and packaged teachings. And then we can move either in the direction of the Jacobin, creating the universal classroom, or of the Bourbon, quite rudely, frankly, and without hypocrisy, stay with a selective school system for perhaps more differentiated elites. And this is the direction in which most of the imaginative educators at this moment, unfortunately, are moving. Or we must become aware that with the same investment we make now in school, we can make the first step in the direction of a society in which we make things transparent and accessible, putting a premium on production of things which make themselves understood, production processes in which people can participate, apprenticeship opportunities even for people who do not want to take a job later on in what we have been apprenticed to, etc. Second, increasing exchanges of skills through a universal skill exchange. Third, peer matching opportunities which provide the possibility for everybody in a modern society to call his meeting on the subject on which he wants, as long as he finds people to meet with him. And the disestablishment of present professions, which rely on certification by peers in the profession, towards a much freer exchange or market, which frightens professionals terribly, in which we provide through a peer matching system some kind of opportunity for everybody. When, if he wants to know, this is a doctor, let me assume. Now I want to know how good he is. I put his name and my address and telephone number into a computer and find out who else is willing to give information about his services. You know, before I go there and find out if I want to be serviced by him as a doctor, a teacher, a psychiatrist, or an engineer or not. I have spoken much longer, 10 minutes longer than I expected. May I ask you now to give me some of your reactions, to tell me where we want to go in this conversation. I'm told that I have to repeat what you say, so if I'll interrupt you after every sentence. Yes. No. It seems that the acoustic is very good, but I can hear you, I'm told. Is it possible to achieve de-schooling without any social changes? May I ask, take reference to this immediately. Usually, people tell me that school is a variable, or the education system of a society is a variable of the social and economic system that society has chosen. And that, therefore, it is almost a crime on the part of myself and other friends to attempt to channel the present dissatisfaction with school into the request for a change in education, because it represents one of the major forces, dissatisfaction with school, to upset the present economic or political structure. My answer to this is that modern school has ceased to be a dependent variable of economic and social structure, has ceased to be simply a reflection of society or a means of just reproducing it. It has in fact become the central agency in consumer production, in the type of social control which is necessary at increasingly higher expenses to produce disciplined consumers for our society. Second, moment, therefore, that if I succeed in seriously questioning the legitimacy of this attempt, the legitimacy of school, I hurt, to use a very graphic example, I kick the modern consumer society precisely where it hurts most, namely into its reproductive organs. Now, what is even more important is that these organs have hypertrophied, have become enormous. In the United States, 145 million people are full-time employed. But of these 145 million full-time employed, only 82 million show up in the labor statistics, because the remainder are full-time employed, institutionally employed as either teachers or students in schools. What, if I rightly read you, I'm reading perhaps behind you what you're saying. You are saying, school is a superstructure which produces the opium which makes us tolerate the contradictions in modern society. I answer you, it is very funny This has happened, of course, in Tibetan and in other monastic societies too, in Tibet. In our society, the purveyor of opium has become the largest employer, the largest labor market, and the largest industry around. Do you see my... I do therefore believe that changes in the economic and political structures can be best brought about by a radical review of what socialization means. And the best proof for this is probably that all over the world, in the industrializing world, no matter what the political ideology is or the political system, schools, and strangely enough, four subsequent quanta of 4 years are used as the official initiation ritual to hide the discrepancy between whatever myth is chosen and the consequences of a consumer society. Does that make sense? Yes. Learning comes primarily through the senses. Learning, if I... As soon as we move into learning theory, which is a perfectly legitimate request that we do, but we could hardly do it properly this evening. But as soon as we do it, one major question comes up. Most people seemingly learn in most of the things which we acquire incidentally as apprentices, and not because we are put into an institution which specializes on teaching, but because we participate in a meaningful process. Not because we are being manipulated in a program by a professional, but because we develop a one-to-one personal relationship with somebody else. Think of the Coleman report. I want to point out that schooling, the modern school, which pretends that everything which can be taught, which can be learned, is better acquired when it is acquired in a purposeful manner, aiming at acquisition, is one of the points, one of the key elements of the ideology of schooling, which we have to question. Yes, learning happens always well when the individual feels a need to acquire something, and it is almost impossible to produce it in somebody who doesn't want to acquire it. As Paul Goodman says, a rat put into a maze hasn't learned anything at all, because take the maze away and the rat is just older and more tired.
You have been listening to another in a series of lectures given on the campus of Iowa State University in Ames. Today, Ivan Ilyich, director of the Centro Intercultural de Documentación Cuernavaca, México, lectured on the topic, A Call for Institutional Revolution. This was the fifth in a series of seven special lectures presented as part of Iowa State University's World Affairs Institute on Latin America. University Lecture is a presentation of Iowa State University Radio.